Hi, I'm Dr. Sridhar Kalyanasundaram. Welcome to my channel. Today is 15th of August, the Indian Independence Day. I wish all of you a very happy 75th Indian Independence Day for my Indian friends. For the Pakistani friends who are watching this, belated happy Independence Day to you as well. One of my friends who are following the channel commented that we could do some MCQ-based discussions that would help the postgraduate trainees as well as those who are taking MCQ-based exams. I was not sure how it would work, but I thought I will give it a go. Based on MCQs, we will have some discussion on specific topics. I am sharing 5 questions in 2 videos, and then we will split the more bulky ones into separate videos as well. If you have any feedback or if you have any questions that you would like to be discussed, please propose the question in the comment box and acknowledge where it is from so that we can discuss. So the questions I've taken are from Essentials of Neonatal Medicine by Professor Sunil Sinha and team, and I've provided a slide of that book in the end. Of course, we can prepare our own questions or share questions from other sources as well. The first topic I've taken is a question based on evaluation of fetal condition and fetal distress. Very important topic. The obstetricians are well versed with it, the midwives are well versed, but the neonatologists and the pediatricians are not that familiar with the terminology used. So I think we will discuss that and be clear about which terms are used. The question is here. A mother presents to a local hospital at 39 weeks, complaining of mild lower abdominal pain and reduced fetal movement since the night before. Her pulse and blood pressure are normal. The fundal height is consistent with the gestational age. She is having contractions. A cardiotocograph is performed. So CTG stands for cardiotocograph, which means the cardiac activity of the fetus is compared with the uterine activity, which is the tocograph. And it shows the following. I would suggest that you pause this slide for a minute so that you can review what is seen. I'm not going to say what is seen here. We will discuss that when the answer is discussed. For interest of time, I request you to pause, analyze, and move on. I will be moving to the next slide now. So the questions we have, the choices we have, this is a non-reassuring CTG. It shows fetal bradycardia. The baby should be delivered urgently. The second choice, the baseline is 160 beats per minute with prolonged decelerations. The baseline is 130 beats with decelerations. This is a reassuring CTG because the baseline rate recovers and the mother should be allowed home after a few hours. The CTG shows very little beat-to-beat variability and should be repeated in 30 minutes. Again, I request you to pause here, select your answer, and then move to the next page. So I'll wait here for a few seconds because the next slide will give you the answer. So moving on to the next slide, this is the discussion on this. So you can see that comparison of the two. The answer is non-reassuring CTG and it shows significant bradycardia, and the baby should be delivered urgently. We will be discussing in the next few slides how to read the CTG, but here basically we have the uterine contractions, the duration of the contraction, and how much pressure is there, how quickly it relaxes. This is the fetal heart. So the baseline is in the 130 to 140 range. There is beat-to-beat variability, as you can see with the zigzag pattern. There is one small deceleration here associated with the uterine contraction, but it comes up quickly. And then here with the start of the uterine contraction, the fetal heart starts dropping. It reaches a heart rate as low as 60. So we know that the fetal heart going from 140 to 60 is dropping of 80 beats, and then it's sustained at that level for a long time. So it's a significant fetal bradycardia episode. And then even if the uterine contraction improves, the bradycardia persists. So this is a delayed deceleration which is persistent. It does recover a little towards the, maybe with fetal resuscitation measures, like the mother's lying on one side with the oxygen to the mother and avoiding hypotension due to the pressure on the cord. and the placental supply. So these are called the fetal resuscitation measures. So this is the answer, because this baby has a very significant bradycardia, and it goes without saying that she needs to be delivered immediately. So the baseline is not 160, and there is one prolonged deceleration. That's correct. The baseline is 130 with decelerations, though the deceleration is not a normal one. So the intervention here, which is a more appropriate point, it is not at all reassuring. The beat-to-beat variability in the beginning is normal, but that is not the point here. The prolonged bradycardia is an important issue. So, as we discussed, we have the fetal heart rate reflected and the contraction of the uterus. So, each point is a uterine contraction. We can see what happens to the fetal heart rate with the uterine contraction, and that's what the cardiotocogram is. So the various aspects of it, so the components of a typical CTG, here the contraction rate is less, that's why you have only one contraction in the view. The fetal heart rate, this is a baseline where most of the heartbeats happen. You have a little deceleration and you have a little acceleration. The acceleration may be related to fetal movement or it may be spontaneous. The presence of an acceleration with the fetal movement is a good sign. And also we look at the presence of acceleration related to changes. So then we look at the deceleration, the timing of the deceleration in relation to the uterine contraction. If it's starting with the uterine contraction and then it picks up before the contraction finishes, it's a type 1 deceleration. Previously we used to use the Eastern terminology, which is not used. If it starts further into the uterine contraction and it lasts longer, the recovery is not related to the relaxation, it's a type 2 uterine fetal deceleration. And variable decelerations are usually due to cord compression related to the labor, where the decelerations are not directly linked to the uterine contraction. The recovery and the depth to which it goes makes a difference in terms of variable decelerations, but most of the time variable decelerations up to 25 beats is expected. And we have the baseline variation or the beat-to-beat variability. So anything between 5 and 25 beats variability is normal. Less than 5 is reduced variability. Repeated variations more than 25 is also abnormal. This is the time interval, and you can see the time mark usually between two lines is 1 minute. So this is depicting the variability we see on the fetal heart rate. You can see that significant variations are there. From here, the baseline is like 140 and it goes up to 160. And again, it's this is the variation you are seeing. Significant acceleration. The accelerations are discounted from your calculation. So this is just the regular variation. And here the variability average is 20, which is healthy. So reassuring is more than 5 beats per minute. Non-reassuring, less than 5 beats per minute. And abnormal is less than 5 beats for more than 30 minutes. The reduced variability here, it's like almost flat. The baseline is 150, but there is reduced variability, so that's a concern. A prolonged deceleration, here the deceleration is starting with the uterine contraction, but with the relaxation, the heart rate is not going back. This is almost identical to the case we discussed. So it's coming up after some time, and then the variability is continuing. So maybe the fetal resuscitation helped, but you need to be very careful with such cases. Here the baseline, it didn't drop to 60, it dropped to say 90, and then it picked up. But this baby is at risk, and you may consider a scalp pH monitoring or other measures if it keeps happening like that, or expedite the delivery. So the interpretation, we have acceleration, which is an abrupt increase in heart rate from the baseline. And it can occur at any time during labor, not necessarily related to the uterine contraction. So it's a reassuring sign of fetal well-being. The NICE guideline states that presence of acceleration is a good sign of fetal health. Variable deceleration, where there is an abrupt decrease in heart rate not related to the uterine contraction. Here it's happening before the contraction. So it's related to usually cord compression. If it it's extremely common, present in 83% of labor. If the variable deceleration doesn't go very low and less than 25 variation, it's fine. The late deceleration, it's a gradual symmetrical decrease in the heart rate. The heart rate returns to baseline after the contraction ends. So it may indicate fetal distress if it is repetitive or severe. So these are the three terminologies in terms of heart rate, acceleration, deceleration, and so on. So we have categorization as normal CTG, suspicious CTG, and pathological CTG. The decision making is based on whether you categorize as pathological or not. The baseline of 110 to 160, as we know, is normal. And of course, if the fetal heart rate has been low for any reason, like a car heart block, which has been diagnosed, maternal SLE may be a factor, then you have to account for that as well. So the baseline fetal heart has to be recorded in your antenatal records, and the normal CTG heart rate depends on the baseline as well before the labor started. The variability, as I said, 5 to 25 beats per minute, and decelerations, there should be no repetitive decelerations. If it is a normal CTG, there is no hypoxia acidosis and you just continue labor as normal. If there is a suspicious CTG, which means lacking at least one of the normal characteristics but with no pathological features, there is a low probability of hypoxia acidosis, but you need closer monitoring. If there is less than 100 beats per minute fetal heart rate, there is reduced or increased variability and sinusoidal pattern, too much fluctuation up and down, or you have repetitive late or prolonged decelerations for more than 30 minutes or more than 20 minutes if reduced variability as well, and one deceleration which is more than 5 minutes lasting. So all these are pathological signs. So we have high probability of hypoxia and acidosis, and you may need to intervene. So we have the feature which is reassuring in the normal heart rate, normal variability, no decelerations and accelerations are present, and non-reassuring, which is bradycardia or tachycardia and variability less than 5 for 40 to 90 minutes, and typical variable decelerations with more than 50% of the contractions occurring for more than 90 minutes, single prolonged deceleration up to 3 minutes. So if it is persistent variable deceleration or single prolonged, it's abnormal. And acceleration, the absence of acceleration with otherwise normal CTG is of uncertain significance, but as I said, the presence of acceleration is significant, that it is reassuring. And abnormal will be less than 100, more than 180, sinusoidal pattern for more than 10 minutes, absent or reduced variation for more than 90 minutes, and either atypical variable decelerations with over 50% of the contractions, or late decelerations both for more than 30 minutes, or a single prolonged deceleration for more than 3 minutes. So these are the factors. Of course, different classification systems use different terminologies. This is another classification from the FIGO guidelines. So we have normal CTG with 110 to 150 beats acceleration seen and 5 to 25 beats variation. The decelerations are early, uniform deceleration and uncomplicated variable decelerations. Intermediary CTG, where you have suspicious pattern, so the heart rate is 100 to 110, 150 to 170 in that range. There is a short bradycardia episode of less than 100 beats for more than 3 minutes or less than 80 for more than 2 minutes. And the variability is more than 25 beats, then it's a saltatory pattern. Less than 5 beats is more than 40 minutes, for more than 40 minutes as well as abnormal. And you have decelerations with uncomplicated variable deceleration where it exceeds more than 60 beats reduction. So all these become intermediary or suspicious. A combination of two or several intermediary observations will result in abnormal CTG. So if you have two of these, it becomes abnormal. And abnormal CTG where heart rate goes very high, like 170, or persistent bradycardia, less than 100 for more than 10 minutes or less than 80 for more than 3 minutes without an increasing tendency. If it is increasing, of course, you don't wait for even the 3 minutes. And the variability is less than 5 beats per minute for more than 60 minutes and sinusoidal pattern. So complicated variable deceleration with a duration of more than 60 seconds makes it pathologic as well or abnormal. And repeated late uniform decelerations, so late type 2 decelerations as we discussed. We have another category here called the pre-terminal CTG, total lack of variability, which is less than 2 beats per minute and reactivity with or without deceleration of bradycardia. So we have to be very careful with these cases, especially if there is bradycardia sinister. So we have something called the CTG sticker. So this is the older version, and we have an improved version which includes more details. So we have the baseline heart rate. You put it in the range at which it comes. You have the range for the reassuring, non-reassuring and abnormal. We have the variability, whether it is more than 5 and less than 5, and you mentioned the time limit as well. Accelerations, if they are present or absent, and decelerations, if they are present, you categorize into what type of deceleration is there. You also mentioned the uterine contraction, the maternal pulse, the presence of lichen color, and the dilatation. So you have the contraction pattern. So whether it is no contraction, irregular, regular, and the tonicity of the contraction, whether it is mild, moderate, strong, and expulsive. So it depends on these features. So in addition to the cardiotocogram, the signs of fetal distress that would need you to consider monitoring the baby closely: reduced fetal movement in the womb. One factor we have to remember is some reduced movement is expected after a dose of beta or dexamethasone for a day or so, but still you may need to take that seriously. Abnormal results of non-stress test or contraction stress test if these are indicated, and abnormal amniotic fluid level, abnormal results of biophysical profile, which we will discuss in the next slide, vaginal bleeding, cramping, maternal high blood pressure, insufficient or excessive maternal weight gain. So these are risk factors. And biophysical profile is just the combination of variables, and you assess them. So fetal breathing movements, gross body movements, fetal tone, reactive fetal heart rate, qualitative amniotic fluid volume. So amniotic fluid volume is an important indicator of fetal well-being, especially if the baby is growth restricted as well. More than one pocket of fluid measuring more than 1 centimeter in two perpendicular planes becomes a normal score, and pockets absent or pocket less than 1 centimeter in two perpendicular planes gives a score of 0. The heart rate variability is mentioned here. The fetal tone, depending on the movements and presence of slow extension and so on. Gross body movements and fetal tone, these are assessed separately. And the fetal breathing episodes are very important, which becomes difficult to assess again when there is reduced Likert. So if there is no or absent episode of fetal breathing movement more than 30 seconds in 30 minutes, it's a score of 0. So the normal biophysical profile score is 8 to 10 if the amniotic fluid index is adequate. Equivocal if it's less than, if it is 6, and abnormal if it's less than 4. And if with oligohydramnios, labor or induction, if it reaches a score of around 4 to 6, depending on the monitoring. If it is low, you would monitor them more closely. You may consider CTG analysis as well. So moving on to the second question, which is on fetal circulation. Which of the following statements is true of the fetal circulation? So 100% of the cardiac output goes to the lungs via the pulmonary artery. The arterial duct or the ductus arteriosus helps to send oxygenated blood to the brain. The umbilical vein carries well oxygenated blood. The foramen ovale typically closes by 36 weeks gestation, and the blood shunts across the duct left to right, that is from the aorta to the pulmonary artery in the fetal circulation. So read the question carefully. I'll pause for a few seconds. You can pause the slide as well to wait if you're not ready. Hope you have decided the answer. I'm moving and the next slide has the answer in it. So the first choice, 100% of the cardiac output goes to the lungs via the pulmonary artery, is wrong. It's actually less than 10% of the cardiac output goes to the fetal lung. The ductus arteriosus sends oxygenated blood to the brain. So the answer is in the fetus. Relatively deoxygenated blood is pumped from the right ventricle up the pulmonary artery and across the duct. So the blood that is pumped into the pulmonary artery doesn't go into the lung, and instead it's diverted to the aorta after the carotid vessel, so it doesn't reach the brain. The umbilical vein carries well oxygenated blood. So this is the correct answer. Unusually for the name, I mean, a vein carries the oxygenated blood from the placenta to the IVC via the ductus venosus. Umbilical cord pH is usually higher for the same reason in the vein than in the artery. The artery is bringing back blood from the baby to the placenta. The foramen ovale typically closes by 36 weeks gestation. So this is wrong because it actually sends well oxygenated blood. It shifts the blood towards the left atrium and only closes after birth. Anatomical closure happens within 24 to 48 hours, but functionally it can stay open. Functionally it closes, but anatomically it may stay open till older ages, as we know. The blood shunts across the duct left to right in the fetus, which is wrong again. So in the fetus, the pulmonary vascular resistance is high, and the purpose of the duct is to take blood away from the lung, which doesn't have any purpose at that stage. So the systemic vascular resistance is low, so the blood shunts right to left. So this is an illustration of the fetal circulation. So the umbilical vein, as the color indicates, is carrying oxygenated blood. So it joins the portal vein and the ductus venosus connects it to the IVG. So it's bypassing the hepatic circulation. There is a sphincter in the ductus venosus which allows this diversion of blood. So the IVG takes the blood into the right atrium as normally, but here as this oxygenated blood goes, there is the Eustachian valve in the lower part of the atrial septum which directs this oxygenated blood through the foramen ovale into the left atrium, and this is circulated to the upper part of the body through the aorta from the left ventricle. The superior vena cava and inferior vena cava deoxygenated blood comes into the right ventricle, pumps into the pulmonary circulation. That's why we said relatively deoxygenated blood. And this blood is taken up into the pulmonary trunk. We have the patent ductus arteriosus taking this blood into the left, the descending aorta, to the rest of the body. So it doesn't go to the brain. And that is why the post-ductal circulation is for the left upper limb and the lower limb. And we have the pulmonary veins which bring the blood. The 10% of the blood that goes through the lungs comes back to the pulmonary vein, and that mixes here. So the oxygenation is relatively reduced compared to what is coming from the UVC, the umbilical vein rather. The rest of the circulation, the blood returns down the aorta, and then you know that the umbilical arteries go through the superior gluteal. That's why the looping happens, and then they come back to the placenta. So just to reiterate again, the blood bypasses the lungs by flowing directly from the right atrium through the foramen ovale into the left atrium. Blood also bypasses the lung by flowing from the pulmonary trunk through the ductus into the aorta. The oxygen poor waste laden blood flows through the two umbilical arteries to the placenta. The placenta disposes of carbon dioxide and other waste and reoxygenates the blood. This oxygenated blood returns to the fetus through the umbilical vein. Placental blood bypasses the liver by flowing through the ductus venosus into the IVC. And the placental blood from the umbilical vein mixes with the fetal blood from the IVC and returns to the heart. So it's very important to understand this concept. Again, we have to remember, please review my videos on delayed cord clamping, and it clearly tells you that the fetal blood and the placental blood are one circulation, and the blood that is supposed to be in the lungs after birth is in the placenta before birth, because oxygenation function is done by the placenta before birth. So this blood actually belongs to the baby, and we have to wait for the baby to open the lungs for the blood to return into the lungs, and the placenta will have reduced blood flow for before you clamp the cord. So that is the physiology of cord clamping. So just to illustrate the differences, the fetal circulation is a low pressure system. There is right to left shunting through the ductus. The lungs are non-functional. There is increased pulmonary resistance for the same reason, and there is a decreased systemic resistance. So it's not a parallel circuit. Mostly it's going through the systemic circulation with only a small proportion going to the fetal and through the lungs rather. In the baby after birth, there is a high pressure system. The left to right blood flow through the ductus if it is open. And the lungs are functional, so this relates to decreased pulmonary resistance. And because the low pressure placental circulation is taken off from the arterial circulation, there is increased systemic resistance. So this is a slide by Dr. Yogen Singh, a pediatric cardiologist in UK, and very well illustrated. So we have the fetal circulation, which we discussed. At birth, we have the cord clamping. And we have the first few breaths after birth. So the moment the baby starts breathing, this usually happens before we clamp the cord. As we discussed, we should wait for the delayed cord clamping. So the first few breaths results in a 5 to 10 fold decrease in the pulmonary vascular resistance and increased pulmonary blood flow. So this leads to increased left atrial filling and pressure. There is a relative functional closure of the foramen ovale, or the left to right shunt happens because of this increased pressure. So this leads to the foramen ovale closing. The increase in the pulmonary vascular resistance leads to reversal of the ductus arteriosus flow. There is also the rise in the partial pressure of oxygen and a drop in the prostaglandins related to the placental circulation being eliminated. All these leads to ductus arteriosus constriction, and the fetal circulation transforms into the neonatal circulation. The one point to remember here is that the fetal adaptation requires the transition of the pulmonary circulation from a high resistance state in utero to a low resistance state after birth. There is a nearly tenfold increase in the pulmonary blood flow, and there is a significant drop in the pulmonary vascular resistance. This continues to decline after birth, and it normally reaches 80% of the total decrease by 24 to 48 hours. One point, very important clinical point to remember, is that this drop is variable, and where there is lung disease or where there is conditions like meconium aspiration or sepsis, the drop in the pulmonary vascular resistance is quite slow, and that is the reason we get persistent pulmonary hypertension in these cases. It may be related to lung malformations, it may be related to sepsis or infections, it may be related to respiratory distress syndrome, it may be related to even hypothermia or a cold baby. So remember that there is physiologic pulmonary hypertension in the first 24 to 48 hours. Any condition which upsets the hemodynamic adaptation of the baby can slip the baby into more severe pulmonary hypertension. So the word pulmonary hypertension is not anything to panic. You have to recognize and correct it. You don't allow hypoxia in these babies. You don't allow them to be cold. You have to maintain the hemodynamics and their general condition. That's why you often see postnatal babies in the first few hours when they are feeding, if they cough or choke, they turn blue fairly quickly. That is because of the increased pulmonary vascular resistance, and that's physiologic PPHN. But we have to be clear that this can easily worsen into pathologic PPHN, like in meconium aspiration syndrome, where it worsens to a level where oxygenation becomes difficult and you may need nitric oxide or ventilation. The PVR reaches adult values around 6 weeks, and the practical implication of this is in relation to the size of left to right shunt lesions if the baby has a congenital heart disease. So the actual assessment, if initially it's not hemodynamically significant, it could become significant when the PVR reduces. So we need to repeat the echo around 4 to 6 weeks for that reason. So the third question is related to screening for Down syndrome. Which of the following statements is true of antenatal screening for Down syndrome? So in the UK, Down syndrome screening is only offered to women over 35 years of age. At the age of 40, the risk of the mother having a fetus affected by Down syndrome is twice as high as at age 30 years. Measurement of nuchal cord thickness at 11 to 13 weeks offers a diagnostic test for Down syndrome. Amniocentesis offers a diagnostic test for Down syndrome but carries a small risk of miscarriage. The neonatal screening test performed after the baby is born will detect if the baby has Down syndrome. So please pause your slide, think of your answer. I'll give you a few seconds. I'm moving to the next slide. I hope you have chosen. If you have not chosen, please pause. So the correct answer is amniocentesis offers a diagnostic test for Down syndrome but carries a small risk of miscarriage. So this is the correct answer. In the UK, Down syndrome screening is only offered to women over 35 years. So this statement is wrong. It's offered to women of all ages, since numerically more Down syndrome babies are born to younger mothers. So the age-related risk is not high, but the younger mothers are the bigger population who deliver babies. So between 25 to 30 years is when most of the mothers deliver these days. And that is the age group, because the numbers of babies are more. That's the group where the Down syndrome happens. So the individual risk increases with maternal age, but the population screening is for all pregnant women. So at the age of 40, the risk of having a fetus affected by Down syndrome is twice as high. It's incorrect again. The risk is eightfold. So it's 1 in 880 at 30 years compared to 1 in 100 at 40 years. Measurement of nuchal cord thickness at 11 to 13 weeks is a diagnostic test. So it's not a diagnostic test. It's one of the screening tests, as we will discuss in the further slides. We discussed the amniocentesis part, which is a diagnostic test. So the cells can be cultured and chromosomal analysis performed from the amniocentesis. So it's a diagnostic test, and the rapid results are available within 48 hours. The other diagnostic test is the chorionic villus sampling, which can happen between 11 and 13 weeks. And nowadays we have studies of genetic studies based on the maternal blood sample, which is even done before 10 weeks. The neonatal screening test performed after the baby is born will detect if the baby has Down syndrome. So this is again incorrect. The newborn screening is more for metabolic problems. You can review my video on newborn screening as well. So the age-related risk of Down syndrome is clearly illustrated here. The risk of genetic problems as a whole is mentioned here as well. So it's about 1 in 1,500 to 2,000 in the younger mothers, and it keeps dropping with age. The reason age results in an increased risk is because of the meiotic non-disjunction risk increasing. The rates of non-disjunction during meiosis increases when the mother's age increases, and that's why the risk of trisomies in general increases as the mother gets older. So at 30 years, it's 1 in 950. At 35 years, it's 1 in 250. And it becomes 1 in 100 at 40 years, 1 in 63 at 42, and as high as 1 in 30 at 45 years. So beyond 35 years, doing the risk factor assessment based on the screening tests is not going to make much difference, because the endpoint of the screening test for Down syndrome is a risk of more than 1 in 250, which is reached at 35 years. So the screening really helps only in the younger mothers. The older mothers, you may offer a diagnostic test straight away based on the ultrasound findings if there is any concern. The blood test based screening is not really going to add much. Of course, if the score becomes even lower, your risk is higher, so you would do it. That depends on the parent's choice. Sometimes the use of the antenatal screening measures depends on what the parental decision would be. So sometimes you have a religious reason for not doing miscarriage or abortion. So you would decide that whatever happens, we will face it. So that's another factor that has to be considered. So we have the tests for Down syndrome, screening tests and diagnostic tests. The screening test includes a biochemical test, which is in the first trimester, triple test, and in the second trimester, the quadruple test. And the ultrasound scan between 11 to 13 weeks, where we look at the nasal bone as well as the nuchal translucency. This gives you a risk factor profile, and you add that to the age-related risk factor profile, and then you decide whether you want a diagnostic test. As I said, if the age itself is significantly high, you can go for the diagnostic test even directly. And as I said, these are the two main, the chorionicular sampling and the amniocentesis, depending on the timing. But we also have earlier tests based on the genetic test in the mother's blood. So these are the tests which are done on the blood test. The alpha fetoprotein, as you might remember, the alpha fetoprotein is increased in neural tube defects as well as the GI anomalies like gastroschisis. But in Down syndrome, it's reduced. In Turner syndrome, it's reduced. In Edwards syndrome, it's unchanged usually. And strangely, in Patau syndrome, it's increased, possibly because of the associated midline defects. Estriol is low in Down syndrome, reduced in Turner's, reduced in Edwards, and it's normal in Patau. HCG is high in Down syndrome. Inhibin A is high in Down syndrome as well. That's why the mnemonic of high can be remembered. HCG and inhibin are increased. The Turner syndrome also, it's very high. Edwards syndrome, strangely, the HCG is very low and inhibin is unchanged. So you can have a guess of what type of problem it is based on the test results. So the last question in this presentation is on perinatal mortality rate. Which one of the following factors does not reduce the perinatal mortality rate? So lower social class, improved antenatal care, improved maternal health, prenatal care and counseling, and maternal education. So the answer is lower social class. Obviously, sorry, I should have paused here, but it doesn't matter. It's an easy question. Improved antenatal care should reduce the perinatal mortality. Same with improved maternal health, prenatal care and counseling, and maternal education. That's why in the developing countries, because of lower rate of booking, so you can use that as a word as well. Booking in the pregnancy is where you have good antenatal care. And booking doesn't mean she's coming for regular follow, but it increases the chances, at least they are aware. The lower social class reduces the chances of their having a booked antenatal care, and so the risk is higher. This is the book that I mentioned, The Essential Neonatal Medicine. So this has at the end of each chapter multiple choice questions, and that's what I've used for this presentation. I hope this is useful. Please subscribe and share. And also I'll be sharing these as individual videos, especially the first three questions which are discussed in detail. Thank you for watching.